Christ the King Lutheran Church, and we do especially welcome the guests and visitors that are here with us today. If I might have just a quick moment of levity, you can be told to social distance, I think, until the cows come home, but no one sits in the front row. Unwritten rules are still rules, right? Well, welcome. I think maybe the rain has kept some of us away, but that's all right. We are here gathered to receive the Lord's word and promises, gathered to receive the gifts that God has promised to give to us. We begin with our first hymn, hymn number 816. Please rise. Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar. Let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins,
and lead us to everlasting life. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We read together the intro. It's found on page 3. Deliver me from my enemies, O Lord. I have fled to you for refuge.
Hear my prayer, O Lord. Give ear to my pleas for mercy. In your faithfulness, answer me in your righteousness.
Enter not into judgment with your servant, for no one living is righteous before you.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Deliver me from my enemies, O Lord. I have fled to you for refuge.
Testament reading for this 15th Sunday in Pentecost is from the Old Testament reading of Genesis chapter 50, verses 15 to 21. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, it may be that Joseph will hate us and pay us back for all the evil that we did to him. So they sent a message to Joseph saying, your father gave this command before he died. Say to Joseph, please forgive the transgression of your brothers and their sin because they did evil to you. And now, please forgive the transgressions of the servants of the God of your father. Joseph wept when they spoke to him. His brothers also came and fell down before him and said, behold, we are your servants. But Joseph said to them, do not fear, for am I in the place of God? As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today. So do not fear, I will provide for you and your little ones. Thus he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is from the Apostle Paul's Church to the Romans, beginning with chapter 14, verse 1. As for the one who is weak in faith, welcome him, but not to quarrel over opinions. One person believes he may eat anything, while the weak person eats only vegetables. Let not the one who eats despise the one who abstains, and let not the one who abstains pass judgment on the one who eats, for God has welcomed him. Who are you to pass judgment on the servant of another? It is before his own master that he stands or falls, and he will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make him stand. One person esteems one day as better than another, while another esteems all days alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. The one who observes the day observes it in honor of the Lord. The one who eats, eats in honor of the Lord, since he gives thanks to God, while the one who abstains, abstains in honor of the Lord and gives thanks to God. For none of us lives to himself, and none of us dies to himself. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother? Or you, why do you despise your brother? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God, so that each of us will give an account of himself to God. And this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And let us please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel.
Said to Jesus, Lord, how often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, I do not say to you 7 times, but 70 times 7. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his servants. When he began to settle, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. And since he could not pay, his master ordered him to be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and payment to be made. So the servant fell on his knees, imploring him, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything." And out of pity for him, the master of that servant released him and forgave him the debt. But when that same servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him, he began to choke him, saying, "Pay what you owe." So his fellow servant fell down and pleaded with him, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you." He refused and went and put him in prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow servants saw what had taken place, they were greatly distressed. And then they went and reported to their master all that had taken place. Then his master summoned him and said to him, "You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. And should you not have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you?" And in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all his debt. So also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We confess our Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed on page 6. We confess,
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. We sing hymn number 849.
Thank you.
peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Our sermon text for today is from Matthew 18 that we read. Again this week, from Matthew 18, again and even more clearly, a sermon and a text on sin and forgiveness. It's hard to avoid one of these, especially any Lutheran pastor. A sermon is trying to bring us to the knowledge of sin, and a sermon is trying to bring us to the forgiveness of Christ. Because without that, we don't have our Christian faith. Without the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins, nothing else is worth talking about. The Christian faith is not about morality, about getting the rules right. Our Christian faith is about Christ, which brings us to sin and forgiveness. And here we are in Matthew 18. Now, in our culture today, things have changed. Things have changed just in the last year, right? Just in the last 6 months. So much has changed on the topic of sin. Because now our protests and our unrest and our disturbances in life that have happened since May even have given us a renewed appreciation for how we can talk about sin. Now, maybe 10 years or 20 years ago, it wasn't that way. Maybe our social discourse about what we could get away with in public wasn't so much about looking someone right in the eye and telling them how bad they were against the world's agenda or against anything else. 20 years ago, it might have been socially wrong to call people out for their sins. It was considered unloving, intolerant, not inclusive. Well, the social discourse today is all different, isn't it? We're a vibrant world full of talking about their sins now, aren't we? It speaks not only of an individual's sins, but of corporate sins of a whole society. It speaks not only of the sins of the present, but sins of the past. We whirl today in a discussion of sin. Is it right? Or is it being handled differently? Our world has suddenly discovered, as the scriptures would say, the height and the depth and the width and the breadth of sin, as opposed to the glory of God. It's terrible. It's disheartening. It's so hard for us to think about this because, honestly, you can't get away from it. Our sin is pervasive. It's complex. It's woven into the ways of life in ways that sometimes it's hard for us to identify. And certainly, there is no quick fix to sin. No easy answer. We've seen it. Burning stores. Statues have been toppled. Friends and families have been divided. And people are dying as everyone struggles to figure out what to do in our society. Where do we take all of this that's wrong? Well, we've been given Matthew 18 to see, rather than talk of sin, we can talk of the coming of Jesus Christ, who comes and speaks to us of forgiveness. Through this parable today, Jesus calls us to a deeper appreciation, not of the height and depth of sin, but of the height and depth and width and breadth of the forgiveness of God in Jesus Christ. Peter really wants to try, doesn't he? Peter really wants to try. How many times should I be allowed to forgive? Should I be made to forgive? Is maybe how he's thinking of this. 7 times? Isn't that pretty gracious? And Jesus just blows him out of the water. 70 times 7. Let's take it all the way. Let's go so far with forgiveness that we don't count anymore, because who's going to count to 490? It's odd to think that Jesus would still need to teach us about forgiveness. With Scripture's constant emphasis on God's love for us, God's steadfast love, on His faithfulness, on His desire that no one would perish. With our liturgical emphasis in our worship on God coming to us in baptism, in the Lord's Supper, in the Word, in confession and absolution, in the sacraments. It's strange that we would need to emphasize again God's forgiveness for us. But we do. Because too often we've let forgiveness become just an individual moment. Just a transaction between God and me, right? We know our sins, we confess them before God, and God says, I forgive you, through the words of Scripture or through the pastor announcing absolution. God proclaims the forgiveness because of Christ who has taken away our sins. We stand before God and we're forgiven. Let's move on, right? We think, oh, we got done. We got the sticker of forgiveness. We got the stamp of approval, a stamp of forgiveness on us again, right? Too often we've limited our experience of forgiveness to just this moment, right? I got proclaimed forgiven again. But Jesus' parable takes it all away from, takes that little idea all away from us. He breaks the limits for this. In this parable, see how Jesus invites us to consider that forgiveness is something more than the moment. It's a way of grace that would extend to our whole lives, because now we live our whole life in the kingdom of God. It creates a relationship that we have with God. We live in forgiveness with Him. And it is also to have this relationship that we have with one another, that we live anticipating forgiveness, living in that with others, and the life we live in God's kingdom. So in the parable, a master calls his servant to account. And this servant has a debt bigger than he will ever hope to repay. And he could be sold into slavery with his whole family. His entire life is threatened. But he puts his life in his master's hands and asks for mercy. He asks for patience. It might sound crazy. What does he have to give? What shouldn't we be beyond that point? Forgiveness. You've got a debt so high we can't see the top of it, right? My shop teacher used to say, your grade is so low that we're going to have to pump daylight down there to figure out what it is, right? He's so in debt that he can't figure out another way to find a way to pay it. And yet he says, could it be possible, Master, that you have mercy on someone like me? And the Master does. In wonderful grace, the Master offers this mercy to this one in debt, this indebted servant. The Master has a different vision. He wants to bring his servant into the kingdom of the Master. Not a kingdom where you pay your debts, but a kingdom where your debts before the Master are paid for you. The Master forgives the servant his debt. And from now on, this servant will live in a kingdom ruled by that mercy, where debts are paid by the compassion of the Master. We live in that grace, in that forgiveness. We don't just see it as a transaction, a moment. But it's a life we live under God. But unfortunately, this servant in the parable, he goes out into the world and he no longer sees himself living in this kingdom of forgiveness. Once he leaves the master's sight, he's back in his own world. How often do we leave these doors and automatically think the way the world thinks again, right? Once he leaves the master's sight, he enters a world where he knows that someone better pay him for the debts owed to him. He threatens. He chokes the man. He threatens to throw him in prison. And when faced with a plea for mercy, a plea for patience, he responds insisting on justice and insisting on being paid. We often call this sermon, or this parable, the parable of the unforgiving servant. It's not just that he's unforgiving, though. It's actually that this servant is clueless. He received the grace and forgiveness from his master, and yet he wants to operate in his own kingdom with others, where there is no forgiveness. For him, forgiveness was a simple transaction with before his master, not a life-changing experience that he would then live in as he deals with others. It was something that he could set aside. I have been forgiven. Not something through which he would always live. I am forgiven by my master and Lord. Unfortunately, we can fall into the same problems. We limit our forgiveness for others to a personal experience. We would say, God has forgiven me, but I cannot or will not forgive that person until certain criteria or demands are met. What demands were met for our forgiveness? The demands were paid by someone else. The grace for us was that Christ paid the demands. Christ paid the debt. Sometimes we will see this. We are baptized. We receive absolution. We receive the Lord's Supper. But that forgiveness is only seen as a moment, something that we experience at church, but not something we have to live out in the world. But forgiveness changes our world. When God forgives you because of Christ, he brings you into a kingdom that reaches the ends of the earth, a kingdom that lasts until the end of time. Forgiveness is not just a momentary experience, a get-out-of-jail-free card that gives you the opportunity to go out and work harder to accomplish salvation. Accomplish? No, forgiveness is our salvation. It is the gift of God. Forgiveness is that life-changing event. It changes who we are. Suddenly we discover that we're not just servants managing our money, but we are children of God who live in his kingdom, where that grace will never end. Sure, we can go back to the kingdom where you pay your debts, where you have to accomplish everything for yourself before God, but God doesn't operate in that kingdom. God extends grace and mercy. If you want to go back to offering a debt to God that you can never pay, there is no hope in that life. But with Christ, there is hope, because the debt has been paid. Your sins, whatever they are forgiven. And Christ has now laid down the last sentence of our text as a room, as a law, a teaching with no wiggle room. That's how it will be also for you if you would withhold forgiveness from someone else. If you would declare that they cannot find the grace of God, that they are without the forgiveness of Christ. Have we been struggling with living in forgiveness for others? Jesus would call us to repent and say, your unforgiveness needs to be forgiven, because your unforgiveness will be as if you are choking that person, insisting that he pay every sin he's done against you, rather than receiving forgiveness from Christ. Our world's conversation about sin can be frustrating. It can bring us to our knees in confession and wanting to try to make right with the world, certainly, when we think we've done wrong with the world. But it can also drain us completely of any strength or hope. It can overwhelm us, because the world would have us work off our forgiveness. And yet Christ will tell us something else. In me, there is forgiveness. In God, there is forgiveness for sins. God has forgiven our sins in Christ. The debt is now paid, and now he calls us. He frees us, and he sends us out with that message of forgiveness to others. How can we withhold it when Christ has bled for it? How can we restrict the forgiveness of God when he has proclaimed from the cross, forgive them, for they know not what they do? How can we say forgiveness must be earned when Christ has said, it is finished? Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Let us rise for prayer. Our prayers are found on page 7 of our worship folder. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty God, as you once kept Joseph from evil and brought good from his suffering in Egypt, deliver us by your grace so that we may learn patience in trials. Teach us to be slow to judge, quick to forgive, and steadfast in love for you and for one another. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful Lord, you have shown great compassion to us. Teach us to show such compassion to others, that we may welcome the stranger, love our neighbor in need, and be attentive to those new to the faith or vulnerable to temptation. Help us to share your gifts with those who live in poverty and want. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Mighty God, give wisdom and courage to our elected and appointed leaders, that they may pursue justice, seek peace, and protect life from beginning to end. Bring an end to the threats of terror and violence among the peoples, and open all nations to the voice of your word. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Blessed Father, you know our weakness of body and soul. Give to the troubled in mind your peace, to the suffering relief, to the sick healing, to the grieving comfort, and deliver the dying into everlasting life. Hear us especially for Wally, Rusty, John, and Marjorie, for John, Darlene, the wife of Jonathan, Randy, and Donald, for George, and for Barbara, and for all those named in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Giving Lord, all good things come from you. Open our hearts to be generous with the poor and to bring you the tithes and offerings you are due, that your church may serve your gracious purpose and suffer no lack of people or resources to do the work of your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty and everlasting God, deliver us from temptation and the powers of evil, that we may be faithful unto death and receive from your hand the crown of everlasting life. Whether we live or die, we belong to you, and we pray you to comfort us with this promise, that we may join the company of the saints on the day you have appointed and enter into the heavenly places to worship at your throne on high, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. I should remind us at times, during this time of great pandemic and mass devastation, we are not receiving or passing the offering plate, but at any time now or after the service, the offering plate will be back in the back and you can place your offering there.
Thank you.
continue at the bottom of page 7 with the preface. Please stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, mercy on us and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. In your righteous judgment you condemned the sin of Adam and Eve, who ate the forbidden fruit, and you justly barred them and all their children from the tree of life. Yet in your great mercy you promised salvation by a second Adam, your Son Jesus Christ our Lord, who made his cross a life-giving tree for all who trust in him. We give you thanks for the redemption you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Grant us your Holy Spirit, that we may faithfully eat and drink of the fruits of his cross and receive the blessings of forgiveness, life, and salvation that come to us in his body and blood. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for the remission of all your sins. Now may the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in the true faith to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen.
Thank you.
continue on page 12 of our worship folder with the Nunc Dimittis. Please rise. Give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Receive now the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Amen. Our closing hymn is hymn number 790. Please be seated.
Thank you.
Again, good morning and welcome to Christ the King Lutheran Church. We welcome the guests and visitors that are here with us today. It is always an interesting thing to see who's coming from where. Some people have greeted me in the last few weeks from all sorts of different states. It's amazing. As we break up today, I want to also commend to you one announcement, especially that our youth confirmation class is starting their next year of instruction, and so this is a high point for me because I've always loved teaching youth confirmation, and it's a high point for them as this is always important. I know,
yay, a high point for me, right?
Right? No, but this is wonderful. Now, in this new world, we usually had lunch during class for this time slot, but since this is the first week and we're still trying to figure out what to do, I'm going to ask them to brown bag it before class, okay? And so maybe if a nice gentleman or two could put up a table back here for them to eat at, that would be handy as well. Are there any other announcements? Something I'm forgetting. We have a leaking toilet. Yes. The world continues to turn the way it turns, doesn't it? All right. Actually, we needed to know that, so thank you for that. If that is the mass of it all, we do invite you to stay for the goodies, for the fellowship, to be part of the chit-chat club, right? And just to enjoy one another's company. And God's blessings on your day and your week.
That should be plenty for all. That's a good church.